Good evening. It's a great pleasure to have all of you joining us today for the special lecture by Professor Gopal Guru. Many of you from different constituent institutions here know about Gopal. He's a professor in the Center for Political Studies at JNU, Delhi. He's one of our leading political theorists, political and social theorists, who has been working on a variety of topics, has had very great influence, not just as an academic, but also as a policymaker, as a member of many government bodies, very influential government bodies at the center. So his engagement with social sciences has been both at the ground level, at the policy level as an activist, and at the policy level with governments, and as an academic. He's been a frequent visitor to our center for the last 2 years. In fact, we are just on a book tour of a book. Gopal and me authored a book called The Cracked Mirror, just released recently. So we were in the Tata Institute of Social Sciences, Mumbai, a couple of days back, and before that at the University of Hyderabad. So we've been traveling. And from Mumbai, we said, why don't you come and spend a couple of days here? And so to talk about some of these issues to our students and others here. So he's very kindly agreed to be with us for these 2 days. Gopal is also a very creative and innovative thinker. And I think what many of us learn from him is not just about certain political stances or political, you know, how to look at political questions, but also to get some deep insights into the nature of Indian society. And that, for us, is a very important point. How does one understand contemporary Indian society in all its complexity? And Gopal, with his very many years of working in the field, working with organizations, brings to this question a great insight. For my colleagues and my students, it's been a great learning experience to have that insight. Today, he's going to talk about quite a provocative talk, and he's also titled it sufficiently provocative, and I hope many of you will get provoked. And that's on casteism. And he's going to talk about how casteism is dead, which would be nice to know, but then how caste survives, the idea of caste survives. So it's a great pleasure to welcome him on all your behalf, and I invite Professor Gopal Guru.
I should take this opportunity to thank MCPH and its director, Professor Sundar Sarukai, for asking me to talk to you this evening. I have a request, sir, that why don't you make me a honorary fellow here? I've been coming so frequently here. So, and this is my selfish interest that I keep coming here, partly because of the faculty and students, and more importantly, the library and the ambience. Each time I come, I get benefited through the discussions with colleagues in MCPH. And students. So it's my own selfish interest that brings me here. I thought today I will speak about something which is so relevant, not for the people who are the victims of casteism, but scholars like us. So there are different positions scholars have taken over the nature of caste system, and the ideology of casteism. I have purposely titled this talk today as Casteism is Dead, but Long Live Caste. It's perhaps something which has some resonance with the JNU slogans, actually. But nonetheless, it's important. I don't know, most of you must be knowing, except, do you know what is caste? Okay, so I just want to, everybody knows what is caste. I don't want to spend my time on defining what is caste. I will, of course, deal with it when I go along discussing with you certain very complex issues that bother us in this part of the world. This particular title is influenced by a very perceptive observations made by one of the leading Dalit leaders from Maharashtra. This title is from the observation made by one of the leading political leaders from Maharashtra. He, in one of his conversation with me, said there is no casteism in political life, urban life of this country, but caste continues to remain relevant in your domestic life, matrimonial life. What he was suggesting, casteism as a social tendency is no more relevant in urban politics, but caste remains to be relevant in your domestic life, family life. And there is a debate, how much role does family play in terms of really orienting, perpetuating casteism in the society? And we have been debating this point. I, along with Sundar, believe that family is a centrally important organization which really plays very important role in perpetuating caste. Even today you can't marry without the wishes of your family. Now you, all the national dailies, you find matrimonial columns full caste descriptions, choices, and those choices are so nuanced. Brahmin bride, Narsimhadev Brahmin bride, I mean, this one example. Kokanastha Brahmin or Iyengar Brahmin, within Iyengar there is something. So you have a very specific requirement that we really flash in the newspaper. Interestingly, you also find caste cluster on the order of merit. Certain castes and their matrimonial advertisements are meritorious and superior, and they are listed on one side, on the top side. In journalism, I think you will understand what is the politics of arranging spaces in the newspaper. And there are other matrimonial columns of advertisement which are listed at the bottom of the page, and they are clustered together. I mean, HIV affected advertisements, Dalit advertisement, tribal advertisements clustered together in one section. So there is also a ghettoization there. So there is also a casteism of a kind followed by journalism. So you know, caste doesn't leave you. Casteism is losing its strength, but caste doesn't leave you. So what could be the difference between two? We'll have to find out. Perhaps I will leave it to you to really make any connection between casteism and caste. But this person's observation is absolutely important. Now, the observation of political leaders, this political leader finds its echo in the observation made by scholars from Indian academia. And I would just give two examples. Professor Andre Bette and Professor Deepankar Gupta believe that caste has become less significant and almost disappeared from the public sphere in metros, Calcutta, Mumbai, Delhi, Hyderabad, Bangalore, Chennai. You do not find caste in these regions. It's difficult. I mean, they are also right. I am not disputing their observation. Now, there is no time for people to really find out whose caste is what. If you go to Bombay local trains in Bombay, 75 lakhs of people commute every day from this end to that end. Where is the time for you to find out whose caste is what? So to that extent, in restaurants and other public spaces, you have no time to really find out whose caste is what. But caste still remains as the reality, even in urban. In Delhi, you just find out, and I think journalism doesn't do this work in Delhi. Just find out the Chaturvarnya reproduced in the big Havelis in Maharani Bagh. You have got four women coming to your house. The one who comes in the morning, time space, the times of matrix involved in this. Who comes in the morning at 6 o'clock to your house? It is scavenger, the Valmiki. She has to come in the morning, clean your sheet and go away and disappear. You can't see her. Okay? Then comes the OBC woman who cleans your courtyard and your drawing room, and she is allowed to enter that for purity pollution matrix. Then there is one person who is a higher caste but who comes for the babysitting. And the most privileged one is the cook, who is invariably upper caste. So you have this reproduction of caste happening even in the domestic. Whom we should hold responsible for perpetuating caste? Male, female? What is it? Another question for the feminist. Who is responsible for perpetuating casteism, male or female? In the most of the cases, female really organize this hierarchy. Her choice becomes supreme. Husband doesn't interfere. No other male member of the family doesn't interfere. Even in JNU, it happens. Okay? So you have caste appearing. If I say provocatively, for most of the caste tenacity, female are responsible. I'm just provoking you. I want you to join issues with me. We'll discuss that. And you know, in the villages, women staying at home, if caste is a domestic reality in the urban, who is responsible? Whose onus is this to really maintain caste? A woman who feels so powerful to really practice this, because her sovereignty is based on the practice of untouchability. She feels meaningful only in practicing untouchability. And just find out. Socially sensitive journalism should do this job on a priority basis in Bangalore. And we have Siddha Lingayya, who is a very prominent Dalit writer, and he is saying that you can't just enter. You have to show your caste. A plumber, an electrician is not allowed by women to enter unless you declare a caste identification at the very at the threshold. So what I am suggesting is that caste is disappearing from the public, retains its hold in the private. And who is the carrier, who is responsible? By and large, women. So that is one submission to your consideration. So Dipankar Gupta and Professor Bethe are right to the extent that caste is not the reality in public spaces. For example, cinema halls. Those cinema halls in the rural towns are important. Most of Dalit killings are done because of the cinema hall thing. Shunduru is this. They were watching movie in the public space, and they were attacked. As to why are you really occupying the front seats? It's not the last seat. It's not your privilege. It is our privilege. And they were all eliminated, 8 of them. So this happens, but metros, you don't get that. Now, there is another set of scholars, and this is a debatable point, and those who are post-colonial social theorists, and I will just mention one, Nicholas Dirks, Caste of Mind, and he is mistaken by many of them. Most of them accuse him of really saying that there was no caste before the Britishers. It's only after Britishers came here they produced caste. Therefore, somebody, I forget his name, birth of caste with census. As if caste was not there in, 1761, there was no caste. The first half-hearted partial survey was taken in 1761. And the regular was from 1871 onwards. 1861 and 1871, regular survey was taken in this country. So there was no caste before 1861, that was the claim. But Dirk is not making that point. What he is making, that caste was there in India before the arrival of the Britishers, but it was in a very fragmented form. What did the Britishers do through census and other disciplinary practices, jailing, medical, regulating the life of sex workers in Calcutta and in Mumbai? All those regular surveys were taken for different purposes. The caste was first of for the first time consolidated, comprehended and consolidated through this technology of the state, as they call in Foucauldian language, governmentality and technology of the government. So that is the point he is making the point that for the first time India caste gets a pan-Indian character. So that is one subtle point that one has to keep in mind and be fair to Nicholas Dirk. There is one amazing position taken by some people. Caste is a rumor. Let me dramatize it. For them, caste is a rumor. There was no caste in this country. Social sciences, social anthropologists, anthropology themselves have faltered in really locating caste. There was no caste in this country. And who spread this rumor? Britishers. And we can't really entertain this position anyway. It's a very, very weak position. Now, in conclusion, one can say that that caste become casteism only through the interaction or encounter with others. Taking cue from Dirks, we can say this. We can make this point in conclusion. What is the source of caste? Why caste become casteism? Caste is one fragmentary reality. It acquires a pan-Indian character through ideological formation. It becomes it becomes ideology and it permeates every other region. Therefore, you have caste consolidation taking place all over the country after the Britishers take over census function. So, you become Yadavas all through the North Indian region and up to Tamil Nadu, up to Andhra Pradesh. So, you have pan-Indian character of Yadavas. So they become a very large social formation existing across regions, and therefore they are consolidating along this ideology of casteism. So it is an interface, so to say, with others that gives rise to casteism. You become one and share one identity, one consciousness, and you fight another. So similarly, non-Brahminism existing from Gujarat, Maharashtra, Goa, down to Karnataka, to Tamil Nadu and Andhra. So there is a cross-regional affiliation, affection. So there are works available on non-Brahmin movement in the Western Peninsula, southern India. So you find this consolidation of caste consciousness happening, and so it is through interaction you find casteism is a kind of a progressive casteism is taking place, caste as an ideology taking place against Brahmanical ideology in the Western and Southern India. Now, I am going to make another point. Who defines caste? One explanation is that it is through the interaction casteism becomes a possibility, not otherwise. If the caste are insulatory, fragmented, isolatory, without any meaningful sociologically intense interaction, then that doesn't really produce any casteism. That's the first submission. Second submission is, who decides caste? And I am going to argue with you that it is only the caste which really confront very intensely with each other, extreme. And there are only two castes, the Brahmins and the untouchable. And in my opinion, these are castes which define casteism, not other castes. OBCs, no. Because their confrontation with the Brahmanical is less and half-hearted. Because there is a lag in their consciousness and therefore they can't confront. It's always the two opposite poles which define the character. So that is my submission, and not many OBC and Bahujan people may not like this, but one has to state it very forcefully. There are people who want to really do it on a regular basis. And George Verghese has given me a book on Wagner, and I was going through this very quickly. There is a need for contrast, and I've just picked up that line from your book. There is a need for contrast. Can the non-Brahmin give this contrast? That's the question I'm asking. It is only the untouchables who can give this contrast to the Brahmins. So that's why this extreme contrast confrontation decides it sharpens the boundaries and defines the very, very sharp, well-defined, polarized character of casteism. Now, casteism, I will define why it is casteism later. It is linked up with origin of caste, and I have something to say about that. Casteism is an ideology, and I'm just taking two strands of ideology. Is casteism a dominant ideology or a hegemonic ideology? That is the poser. Most of the I mean, most of the sociologists and social anthropologists, taking cue from M.N. Srinivas, would say caste is dominant. Once you say it is dominant, then it acquires certain characteristics to itself. It is dominant, therefore it is non-negotiable, it is less liberal, it is authoritative, it is dominating, it is coercive, it bullies you, it doesn't tolerate any opposition, it subjugates you completely. Dominant caste. So dominant it is, and as M.N. Srinivas would say, but dominant in terms of numerical strength and material entrenchment. And that's why they become dominant. Entrenchment, that your land, your assets, and you also are numerically larger, so you become dominant. You don't have to bother about it. You don't have to even rhetorically accommodate people into your own system of patronage. You can just count on them, decimate them, to pulp them into insignificance. That is the confidence that dominance really. So is caste a dominant ideology? I'm not answering. I'm just answering. The other question is casteism hegemonic? And I think the second, hegemonic, is more important, because no caste in the country can really rule or dominate through coercion, force, subjugation. It has to really rule through hegemony. In hegemony, as we all know, and we are just borrowing from Gramsci, in that, you know, in hegemonic order, ideological order, you don't coerce people whom you want to subjugate. You give them little space to breathe. You also accommodate into your symbolic structure. Oh, you are also nice. Like Annapurna is an ideology for women. Annapurna, you are a great Annapurna, you are Sati Savitri. This ideological accommodation of women into your patriarchal structure, so that you don't complain, oh my God, so my husband called me Annapurna. The goddess of abundance. So you feel happy, you participate in your own subjugation, therefore. So you participate in perpetuating the dominance, that's why it's hegemonic. There's a hegemonic take on this. And you can replicate in terms of Dalits. So that is hegemonic. And most importantly, now we should thank Professor M.N. Srinivas for giving us this very wonderful term, Sanskritization, which is a project of hegemonic. It really carries forward, transform hegemonic order from one generation to another generation through Sanskritization. And what is Sanskritization? Sanskritization is one such ideological process. This is for the first time one is using this term. So much of literature on Sanskritization, I'll predict it sometimes back, 10, 15 years back, I is just nominal, this is not first person singular, I is somebody who wrote on Sanskritization, a critic of Sanskrit later, sometimes 15 years back. Sanskritization is one such ideological process in which the victim of casteism participates in his own or her subjugation. Why do they participate? This is because it offers them a chance to enjoy relative social worth over others who are right below them. For example, left hand and right hand. In Karnataka, Adi Karnataka, Adi Dravida. Adi Karnataka will always find, you will enjoy superiority over Adi Karnataka. Malas will always enjoy superiority over Madigas. Like Mahas will always enjoy superiority over Mangs. So likewise, the Pallas will always really enjoy superiority over the pariahs. Likewise, the Chamas will always enjoy superiority over the Valmikis, the scavengers so called. So there is, you are getting relative advantage, and this is called in Dumontian, Louis Dumont's Homo Hierarchus, a very interesting phase, that it is a continuous hierarchy of which everybody is a beneficiary. So why do you want to fight against this? You feel you want to imitate the upper, their norms and their values, and that's what Sanskritization is all about. You don't want to reject them, you want to follow, imitate that, and reproduce the same hierarchy at the local level, lower level, and that's what continuous hierarchy. And Dipankar Gupta might say it is not true, even the Brahmins are not allowed in the untouchable houses in Tamil Nadu, that's the example he gives. But that's episodic and continuous. What signifies, what is the essence of your hierarchy? The episodic one, the temporal one, the continuous one. The substantive and the temporal. We can't derive a subsidized satisfaction. Oh, there's exception to it. And therefore there's no, Louis Dumont is a failure. Louis Dumont is not relevant. That should be a wrong, I mean, it's a partial reading of the situation. Now, most important, casteism and caste have simultaneous emergence, origin. That's my point. And that's the point I think I have not come across, but that's the point which is a very problematic point I'm making. I want your indulgence in this. Any hegemonic ideology, including casteism, is about legitimizing the structures that underlie and renew patterns of inequality. In our case, social inequality. And even in economic inequality as well. Any hegemonic ideology, including casteism, is about legitimizing the structures that underlie and renew patterns of inequality. The ideological principles like purity pollution and ideological forms of ritual hierarchy will help in legitimizing this ideology. The question that has to be answered is that how did caste originate? Was caste before or casteism after? Was casteism before or caste later? So that is the question which we have to answer. Everyone knows, I'm not going to give you different theories of origin of caste, but I am going to give you only one which is dominantly practiced by Indians, common Indians in India, and which is Purushottam. And how is caste originated? It is originated from the giant cosmic figure called Brahma. And you know, head, arms and all that. The head, many people know it. Do you want me to repeat it? The Brahmins are originated from head, and the Kshatriyas from arms, and the Vaishyas from thighs, and the Shudras from feet. This is the hierarchy. The body itself, when we are talking about Judith Butler, we must tell her, look here, we have a different notion of body. So she has an important work too. We have now started comparing our body and understanding our body with them. Now, Phule, Ambedkar, everybody really ridiculed this. Because they are rationalists and scientific. Phule himself was so, Jyotirao Phule, a 19th century social thinker from Maharashtra, ridiculed this. He says, how can you reproduce men without having undergone a biological process? And he said, when did a god undergo a menstrual process? All that, Phule, is deeply anthropological, going into the nuances of all these rituals and other things. And I haven't seen any very, very erudite anthropologist, Phule's understanding of mythology, myths and other things. Wonderful. But that's in the Mahakavya and it's not available in translations. So we have to, even I have to take trouble in reading his own Marathi. We are discussing, in our afternoon informal discussion. The Purush Sukta is the most famous Sukta. People follow in this country this. And four Varnas were produced first and they got degenerated into several castes. And these are more than 3,000 castes. And subcastes and subcastes and subcastes. So every caste becomes a cluster of subcastes. So that is the formation. It's a very complicated thing. And we will come back to it and we're discussing about the marriages in Shivoga. And I think you need to tell us what is the whole situation about Havak, Brahmins and others. I'm little frank, please forgive me by being frank in taking names. Okay, everyone knows Purush Sukta. I have just told that story to you, story of origin of caste. Claiming that the caste is God-given tends to immediately implicate caste into casteism. The moment you say is God-given, you are already implicating casteism into caste. That means you are already rejecting there is a biological, rational explanation beyond the origin of caste. You are already dispensing it onto some supernatural authority to having produced the caste system. So that ideology is already in progress and invoked here immediately, simultaneously along with the origin of caste. Caste becomes casteism to the extent that this theory does not give us the real source of the origin of caste. Caste has false consciousness, therefore. As has been argued by the thinkers from the lower caste, it is not God who has given us the caste system, but it is man-made. It's a patriarchy, not, there is a debate. Who is responsible for casteism? It is women, they say. But it is wrong. It's wrong, it's not women. Reproduction does not make caste, it's not a biological factor, it is ideological construction. Let us see that. So those who dispense it on, those who hold women responsible for having produced and perpetuated casteism along the lines is absolutely wrong. Okay, the yoni connection. And full and everybody is doing that. Ambedkar has a women, balancing women number, and that is the pressure. I mean, you have to have equal number of women, and to maintain equal number of women, you have to really restrict your marriages, and therefore you produce and perpetuate caste. So that is arithmetic. Okay. Now, since caste, the origin of caste is not a simple thing, it is a very complex matter, we need to take into consideration another very interesting complex theory of caste, which is provided by Modern Class. It's very, very influential book on the origin of caste in origin of social caste, origin of social stratification in this in South Asia. That's the title. Now I am taking from, I'm just building on to what Modern Class is saying. It is very interesting. It is the first interdisciplinary approach to caste. Caste is not the result of one singular imagination. It is the multiple imagination is at play in terms of producing caste, origin of caste. Now, what is that? And I just want your indulgence into this complex formulation. And I'll go slowly. Can I take another 10 minutes? This is the first section of my presentation. On the line of Modern Class, I would like to take the support of economics, geography, Arvind, ecology, politics and sociology, of course. All these major disciplines are important in understanding caste and the origin of caste. I would like to argue that caste as an ideology emerged simultaneously along with the emergence of the surplus in agriculture. The word surplus is very important. The human communities then did two things at a time to gain surplus. What did they do? They domesticated plants and also animals. What is the plant they on a priority basis domesticate? Interesting for these people from this region and Kerala and Tamil Nadu. They domesticated rice first. It's a wild variety. No one knows what is rice, but they domesticated rice. And they say it is women who are singularly responsible for inventing rice. I don't have any conclusive evidence, but women have invented rice and wheat. That's one scholar, Indologist, whose name is Sharad Patil, who says that it's women who invented rice. So rice is domesticated on priority basis, from wild variety to domesticated variety. And rice was invented 6,000 years ago in the regions of Bihar, as it was called Magad Desh then, West Bengal, Orissa, Andhra, Karnataka, Kerala and coastal Karnataka, Tamil Nadu, Kerala and coastal Karnataka. And why? Because heavy rains here and you require heavy rains for cultivation of rice. Okay. So you are producing rice in this region And rice is the variety which is very, very, which is very efficient in terms of producing surplus. Why did they start cultivating on the plains and gave up hunting and other things and finding food, hunting for food, wild food, fruits and animal, wild animals? They domesticated plants like rice and also animals like cows, bulls, buffaloes and horses, as we know the story, Didikosambi frame. The energy spent in hunting, this is important, the energy spent in hunting than the energy recovered through nutrition obtained from the hunting was far, far greater. Why there was a need to domesticate plants and animals? Because the energy spent in hunting was much larger, much greater than energy recovered from that nutrition. Very important. This is modern class, and I think so relevant. Therefore, you never wanted to spend energy in hunting. You wanted a piece of energy, and therefore you needed to domesticate, stabilize forms of cultivations, domesticate plants for the stabilize more assured forms of reproduction, production in agriculture. First important point. In the beginning of rice cultivation, therefore, is the beginning of obtaining surplus. That's the first connection. Can we therefore say, taking cue from modern class, I have no conclusive evidence, I am very shaky on this claim. Can you therefore say that caste originated first in West Bengal and Magadh Desh than in Rajasthan? Rajasthan is dry. So caste arrived in Rajasthan pretty late than it arrived in these regions, rice producing region. Can you say that? And there is evidence, and I would go along with this person. What is the first social revolt? Where is the first social revolt? Which part of the country? The country, the way you imagine this country, is only Magadh Desh. Buddhism, Jainism, all these heterodox philosophies taking shape against Brahmanism in these regions only. So there is a chance to say that, you know, there is a possibility of saying that casteism arrived there and it then slowly, gradually, spread other parts of it, occupied other parts of the region. This is an open-ended question. I'm not giving any conclusive opinion on this. No judgment is it is possible. The reproduction, continuing this logic of surplus, the reproduction of population, required for agriculture production. Reproduction of population is required for reproduction of agriculture. In turn, require surplus in production. You require population to cultivate agriculture, and for making population survive, you require surplus production. The human being did not eliminate population then. Important. Just as we have ruthlessly indulged into female feticides today, they did not kill their babies. They did not weed out their oldies, old senior citizens then. I'm senior citizen. They took the moral responsibility to feed them, therefore, I think the starting point of family in other community life happening simultaneously, because you're not eliminating people, you are allowing them to survive and survive meaningfully on surplus. And therefore, you require production and production of agriculture and reproduction of population. Maintaining hold over the surplus, that's the important point. Now, surplus is there. Maintaining hold over the surplus was the social necessity. Maintaining hold over the social surplus was a social necessity. Maintaining hold over the surplus through force was not desirable, as it involved greater risk of self-destruction. You know, you could be annihilated in terms of, you know, plundering each other's surplus. So, and that's how you find till what, you know, what is the history, social history of caste? Was it really completely violent right from the very beginning? It was manipulative, it was crafty, it was cunning, was it coercive? And you have references in Shambhuka's eliminated, beheaded and all that. We have references, but let's see what is the idea. Therefore, you find the first, you require something else more than force. And therefore, you find Chaturvarna as a handy weapon to divide people and subjugate them through organizing them around this relative worth, social worth. And as and when, and this Manusmriti is not one time story here, it evolved and progressed and perfected over a period of time. Okay, that's, it's not one time, one person sitting and giving codifications. Over a period of time, Manusmriti is codifying with much stricter laws, rules and regulation, and therefore there was a need to fragment Varnas into several castes and make them perfect. And who was the victim? Women, Shudras and Atishudras. They were the ones who got the most difficult time from the codification in Manusmriti. So you have this Manusmriti really as an ideological document in perpetuating hierarchy, purity, pollution. And we have stories about purity, pollution. I don't want to tell you anything very, very extraordinary about it. But they were women, Shudras and Atishudras were excluded from holding assets. You know that women were not allowed to study Sanskrit, excluded, no education to women. There are people like Arvind Sharma and others, oh, there was a promise of equality in Manu Dharma Shastra. But who should ask this question? Who should give the judgment? Women or Arvind Sharma? It's women who should give the judgment. Oh no, it's a perfect there. We are no problem. But there are women. You know, I had been to Banaras and I saw one woman defending Manusmriti. I said, oh, kya ho raha hai? So it is, I mean, ideological construction is perfect in that case. Shudras were not allowed to hold property, land, no education. Atishudra was not a part, that's a different story. And what about their property? And we have negative rights. Donkeys, dogs, not even cats. Leftover clothes, leftover jutan, leftover food. All this was their property. Negative rights into property as given by Manusmriti, not positive rights. Now, once you are excluded from this, and why are you excluded? You don't complain about it. Ideological influence, impact is complete on you. So much so, you find in Premchand's Kafan, and there are many, in Anand Murthy Sanskara Perfect, it's sociological document actually. We must really read it with great interest. And I've been reading it again and again. Sanskara, you must read on priority. In Kafan, and Nikhil, just correct me if I'm wrong. The Brahmin goes to this fellow's house. Who should take objection to crossing boundaries? The Brahmins. But he doesn't take, he is a protagonist in that particular thing. And he is wanting to get into the house of an untouchable, but untouchable is opposing it. Sorry sir, you can't enter my house, it will be adharma. Why are you bent upon to violate your own dharma? Stick to your boundaries. As we know, ideology is transgression. Ideology is transgression. So the impact is so perfect, and I am just giving one example. There are several, but one example. Now this is the ideology. So ideology, caste becomes ideology simultaneously along with the emergence of caste. It has its origin in surplus of rice. Rice and surplus has to be maintained, the holdover surplus has to be maintained, because you want to, and the socially dominant people want to maintain the surplus, they want to take hold of the society, regulate it, and then for you therefore you find elaborate arrangement of casteism happening to protect. This is a bit ecological, economic, ecological, Marxian interpretation of origin of caste. I think this is the most convincing interpretation. I may be wrong, but I hold this view that otherwise there is no need. If there is no vested interest in your social position, why do you want to perpetuate caste? Why there is a need to really exclude people from the land holding on the basis of caste? Even today, you want to, even in capitalism, you want to seek exclusion of people not on modern irrational terms, on pre-modern irrational terms. You might say there is no casteism in IT industry and other things, but is it the case? I mean, casteism is so much systematized and so much structured that you would never know. It is so much normalized that you would never know that there is casteism. It is the parallel system, education system, all those people who land up ultimately in IT industry or IITs, forget about reservation, just keep it aside. But how does caste operate silently? Who is going to Goenka school in Delhi? Just take their social background. There is no reservation. 25% is not still applicable there. It is applicable in Bangalore, and you know what is the situation in Bangalore. Okay. So one kind of people are going there, passing out from there to elsewhere, and that journey continues without the sense of caste. And sameness is not caste. It's only difference. I'm making that point again and again. You know your caste when you confront the other who is from the other planet. You know this casteism when you face this 25% people in Bangalore school. Otherwise, it's so normal. Your friendship is so universal. Your cell phone conversation is so benign. There's a student noise here. It doesn't even. Don't want any shrilling noise on a cell phone. So the friendly, intimate conversation takes place within the same, the notion of same, perpetuate casteism. You might say that you are advertising it through internet and this, that. Who lands up ultimately? Very systematic. You tend to become aware only when your family is forcing you to marry a particular girl. And please read, and I am reading it, S.V. Ketkar's idea of caste. You are not allowed to enjoy your individualism without constraint. So family becomes a problem. Family makes you aware about your caste. And that's why advertisement and other things. I'm just giving you one example how caste operates in market, other things. But I will stop here, and I'll be very happy to discuss with you some of the issues about which I was very, very dramatic, sometimes very ill-informed, and sometimes very, very unintelligible. So I'll stop here. Yeah, thank you.
The best way for me to give you an illustration of that is to tell you what I heard in Shimoka, since he said that. That's a story which I think is very interesting. Apparently, what is happening in these regions, Malnad regions largely, and this was told to me by a community of people who live there. And this was in the context of a marriage of a person who is from the Havir Brahmin community. And it was in this marriage context, this person said, I mean, there are a group of these Havir Brahmins who are with me, and they said, the problem today is the Havir Brahmin woman does not want to marry a Havir Brahmin guy in the rural areas. By the way, it's very interesting. I've heard this problem about finding enough brides in Brahmin community quite distributed. I mean, you can see the real story across different communities. So, we were in this marriage where this person, who is a poor Havya Brahmin, goes to a place near Kundapur and marries an arranged marriage set up by a marriage broker, to a Vishwakarma. It's a so-called different caste. But the Vishwakarma Brahmins, I mean, they call themselves the Vishwakarma Brahmins. And it was very interesting. It was very interesting, one of the most interesting and simplest marriages I've seen. But here are these two people getting married, and the community of the girls were not Brahmin in any sense like the Havya Brahmins were. So while we were eating lunch, many of the Havya Brahmins were saying, no, they are not really Brahmins. But the Vishwakarma Brahmins are Brahmins because they have a sacred thread. So the question is this, and there's a challenge which, you know, in our own debate on this, we've been coming back to this question, what makes somebody a Brahmin? If you put a sacred thread, do you become a Brahmin? And many people think that they do. How? This Vishwakarma example is a very good example, because that is the idea of Sanskritization. I mimic the rituals of the higher people in order to go up the caste hierarchy. Putting the sacred thread immediately seems to allow these people. So the example you were saying is actually with, you know, Prasanna Srinivas, who suggested this, is, it's actually very powerful with all its critique. I see it happening more in the ways in which people appropriate rituals and so on. So I think what Gopal raises is, while caste has undergone various mutations and so on, there's seemingly an undeniable reality to its influence in social relations, the way it orders our experiences in society. In fact, we were talking about a very important point with another group of people from Bangalore who are insisting that there's no caste in urban areas. So I just want to add a very quick comment about that. Those of you who would have seen a series of articles in Hindu, I think maybe 2-3 weeks ago, would have discovered something which people have been writing about for a long time, which my students in my earlier institute in Bangalore used to say. They said that, you know, when these students came to get houses in Bangalore, in Malaysia, where the institute was, they said we couldn't get houses for them because of our caste and religion. In Bombay, at no time in Bombay's history has it been as bad as now. The consolidation of castes who have taken over neighborhoods is so strong that you cannot get, if you're not a Jain, you cannot get houses in a particular area. Because everybody freezes you off. There's no written agreement which says, if you are not Jain, don't apply for a flat here. I mean, remember these are in the open market. These are flats you can buy. If you think, you know, that's capitalism, transaction of money. But there are so many unwritten rules in urban spaces. It's about Muslims, it's about Christians, it's about different castes and Hindus. I mean, the way it operates seems to become so insidious and part of daily life. So this is the challenge. You know, at one level, there seems to be a resistance against caste in even urban areas. But on the other ways, a private consolidation. You know, so I'm very glad you brought the question up. I'm sure that many of you have perhaps complicated questions, so please feel free to raise these issues. And since we are among friends, let's see where we go.
Yeah. So, if we examine a few other social structures, such as the armed forces has a very elaborate way of structuring its men. You have the soldiers, then the junior commissioned officers, and the officers, and a very strict, it is strictly followed in the behavior. A general does not sit and have food with a soldier. It's very simple, they have different messes. Different places of worship and things like that. In a college, and we have untouchability seen in the sense a person with 50% will not be allowed to touch the paper of a company which has a cutoff of 60%, say. Now, that's the second thing. The third thing, the law of evolution, it ensures that human beings are not born equal at all, so that there is a constant improvement in the genetics of mankind. Now, when we combine these three, is it possible to say that a caste system, any sort, will ever evaporate from society at all? Because it is, at the end of the day, just a method of organizing men.
I mean, genetic, you should do that, sir. I have the answer for you. But, you know, social stratification based on status is one thing. which is universal. In the 18th century, yes, 18th century, 1776, Adam Smith wrote the first theory of moral sentiments. It's all about these hierarchies in British society. Okay? But we don't read that book, we didn't mention of wealth and all that. But here in this, hierarchy is the order of the day. Over fame, tradition, over rage, those people. The classic sentence which Amartya Sen mentioned in his book as well, borrowing from Adam Smith, is that people did not have a chance to appear in the public without the sense of shame. They were shamed everywhere, club, everywhere. So that hierarchy, is that hierarchy same as the hierarchy in our country? That's the point. You know, when untouchability becomes the idea, deflects itself from identity to becoming idea, that is much more pernicious and intense. You don't require a human being to practice untouchability. Very idea is that what? So you will have a modern, that's what Weber would say, stratification. Those are all secular modern stratification about which people in the military will not object to. Okay? And that is not new. Even in Shivaji's time in 17th century, if for nothing doing, the Mahar will be camping along with the Brahmins. Brahmins took objection to Mahars being camped together. Shivaji said, get lost. He said, get lost. That's Marathi translation. So, there are two things that we have to keep in mind. See, for example, this marriage thing, untouchability, and we have discussed this at length in our conversations in phenomenology of untouchability and the archaeology, how deep it is. It's not as simple as superficial as ministry thing. Okay? So that, and somebody was mentioning in the morning, new forms of discrimination, but they are not as same as the untouchability. So you should keep that in mind.
It's genetic. That, you know, to say that in an army, that, you know, or to say that the person who gets 50% is untouchable, is to actually miss the point about untouchability, which is of genetic origin, in the sense that a person who is born to this untouchable can never aspire to get out of that cycle. Now, if you get 50%, if I get 50% and I can't, I'm not taken by a company, I'm not untouchable in that sense, right? I mean, you should remember, you should place it in the history of untouchability. When people in Kerala, down this region, what was most oppressive about untouchability? If a person's shadow falls upon you, you are defined. You should read the autobiographies of some of these writers, people who are living with untouchability. It's just it's shocking to the larger world, which hasn't seen this. You know, even today, it happens in almost all the places. You will see how laborers who are probably from the untouchables and the so-called Dalits behave when they see somebody walking across them. They will move out of the way. In villages today, if you're walking on a band with the field down, they cannot be seen by the person who's coming. So you will have to manage. The other person will continue walking. And the fact that it is genetic means your child has no hope. Even if she scores 80%, cannot get into the company, cannot get into the institutions. That's, you know, we have to make sense of this. Why? I mean, I think it's a very complex thing. Why this kind of a thing originates? Even class in Britain, there is a lot of overlap, similarities. But at some time, the class structure changes when it is not genetically that. Even poorer people, when they start getting into the richer class structures, getting into Oxford, Cambridge, and so on. Earlier, all education was only for the rich gentry. You know, it happens in 16th, 17th century when there's a shift in, you know, poor people entering into education. Why doesn't that happen in the case of the untouchables? If 16% are the Dalits today in India, their representation in almost all public spaces is minimal. I mean, just the other day somebody was studying, this is the statistics, okay? Maybe last year, 1.5 years back, in IIT Madras, 75% of faculty are Brahmins. What sense do we make of it? I'm not saying, you know, what does it mean, you know, these are very complex questions. What does it mean when that representation has become like this? Have people been denied, has one community been denied complete access to society? You know, when you say it's individual is good and therefore they should grow up, but individuals are formed by society and support we've all received from a society, right? From being in a particular community. That's been denied.
Systematically. Yeah.
What do you?
two things. And one is the to raise it to the level of concepts we can and take up two terms. One is snobbery, the other one is stigma. Now, what you are suggesting is part of snobbery. I mean, you are 60% you are untouchable. There is untouchable in the original, and that's a handy concept. You can use and beat people with. And stigma, snobbery has been universal, secular, modern. So, you know, so much so that in 200 years back in Harvard and Oxford University, women are not allowed to enter the campus. And there's an interesting book by Judith Clark on Ordinary Voices. You find this reference. Women are also considered to be exclusionary object. So that is snobbery. What is stigma? You continue to be untouchable without really carrying the markers of that, visible markers on your body, you still are considered to be untouchable. So you are absolutely, as they say, ontologically stigmatized. You have no escape at all. You continue to appear and reappear in the same form, irrespective of your location. And you may not like Satyamaya Jayate, but there is an IAS officer who is not at all within the field of untouchability. His own view is a Pandeji. He is discriminating on the carpets to this fellow who is his boss. And this fellow can't do anything. And I am not going to give you Ambedkar's example. Ambedkar is a foreign written barrister, expert, but his tune, the rigid character there in that office, was hurling files at him without not touching. So, I mean, these are all issues that we, and this happens, you know, even today in hostels of student hostels, you find condos are reserved. I mean, there are different stories. Tej Bahadur Medical College in Delhi, and there was a big, so you have, I mean, something which is really, which is handy to you, and you can always use it against some people. The moment you see that those guys are going ahead, use that to really undercut their significance. So that's it.
Yeah. And the point which is raised is about manual scavenging. Across places where manual scavenging still exists, who are the people who are doing it? You don't find any of the other castes doing it. Why for generation after generation, one group of people have to do manual scavenging, which by the way is illegal, right?
Yes,
so really.
Sir, I would like to get your views on the links between caste and race.
Caste and race?
And if at all it is related, then does it confer certain characteristics to that caste?
They are not related, first of all. They are separate because of obvious reasons. And you might establish some kind of a relationship at different levels, normative levels, but sociological levels you find, and even biological levels you find them to be absolutely separate. And some people try to read caste into race and race into caste, and taking cue from Herbert Risley, who believes in this racial theory of caste very firmly. Even Pooley believed in this, many people believed in this, but Ambedkar did not. So, simple thing is obvious, you know, color would give you the idea of which social government you belong to. In terms of caste, color is not the very, very efficient indicator to really track you down to your social background. A very deceptive category, you know. Because, you know, if you take color, and that in Indian philosophy, I think Varna is different, not race. Varna is something which is. Says Gaur Varna, but you know, Varna is the one class of words as I was reading this book in the morning. Race is to be defined in terms of your color, your physical characters. Caste is not. That's one important distinction between the two of them. And the theory of race doesn't hold water because you know, you have, and I don't want to say anything, but you must say that, you know, Brahmins are supposed to be light-eyed, blue-eyed, complexion, sharp features, and all that. And we have spoken as the Brahmins there. They are the ones who are the model, role model. Now, do you get this variety anywhere? No, This is the uniform variety in this country. No. So racial theory, I mean, and race is also construct. It's not a, I mean, there are works on this. I mean, there is a very interesting poem written by an 8-year-old boy from South Africa, the UNO. You know the story? The poem? What is it?
I am
black. I am black.
Yeah.
So but you know, there are attempts by the modern social activists who go to Durban and other places to find out similarity between the two authors.
Any, just like your observations on that.
Yeah, that's something I'm taking from my friend. There is some kind of flexibility. Cool is very important. That's how your Khap Panchayat. Khap Panchayat in Haryana is not allowing you to really marry outside that particular clan. And inside the clan, Cool becomes a concerning authority. You just cannot marry within the clan. The moment you marry within the clan, you are eliminated. But clan becomes important endogamic device to maintain your caste. Very, very closely guarded. But modern technology, modern occupational structures have really allowed some kind of flexibility in this. And you were mentioning, you know, in the morning, the, you know, anybody from Mangalore to West Bengal can marry within the same caste existing at the horizontal level. But the vertical possibility is not there. Now, for example, marrying a Shudra is not possible at that level. And you said Havak, Smartha, and what?
I don't know the third one.
The third one, but two, they have made some concession and they have gone publicly saying that now we are relaxing the rules and now there is a flexibility. But interestingly, what is casteism? We want somebody, some Bible from this caste, upper caste, particular Brahmin. But any Brahmin would do. Caste no bar. Caste no bar. But outside SC than ST. What are you suggesting? So this is, clan is so important. You have gone so much ahead in terms of your IT, technology and everything. Yet you are sticking to this. You just look at the columns. And Sainath has done a study, classified them. He Sainath. We all know, we look at those columns every day. You find that this is what is happening. And for the first time, you know, I was amazed to see the Chitpam Gamins are the most modernist people who really do not require any caste tag to them. But suddenly you find them organizing along caste line, Parshuram Sainath. Why that? Is there a dent in their modernity? Do you want that suffix to your identity of why you can't survive without being called as Cobra and Coconut the Brahmin? Okay. So that's the, well, that's just tight, there are two, I mean, you have to stand up.
I just have an observation to make in terms of the theory of agricultural state. If you look at the Egyptians, they had an extremely hierarchical order, ruler like God, they had a scribal unit, they had a religious priest like all the necessary components that we see in this example of India.
Still not the same as class, right?
No, but
I mean, class is just a very formalized structure that's built in.
Yeah, there's no problem.
Now, you also just add to that, you have to ask why in the so-called most important texts of the culture, like the Rigveda, the Purusha Sutta, it is inserted into Rigveda. It's apparently not Rigveda. Fritzl's argument has been put in name wrong. It's part of the Vedic text, this, you know, division by the base of the body. It's there a part of Bhagavad Gita. That kind of legitimization which happens in the sacred text of a culture may not happen in these other places, and we need to understand that.
But I'll also add to this quickly, this India untouched by the Scandinavian movie. Look at this Brahmin Pandit, the Banaras. What is his explanation? Same. No, somebody asked him, you don't feel sorry if the Dalits are killed. Yes, we feel sorry, we become emotional. Because if the toe is hurt and bleeding, our eyes cry. My God, what a super idea. That
is,
are
you? government did present a single view. And he highlighted a number of challenges confronting this society, especially unity for class and class system. So do we have any alternative to the existing social structure where we can make certain recommendations? How this we can really restructure this existing infrastructure?
The only alternative is to eliminate caste.
What is the question?
Because alternative to caste.
Is there an alternative
through which you can really bypass caste and do some good things in Indian society? I think we can first of all, I don't have great ambition, but start smiling at each other first of all. You don't smile. No, in the villages, you hate them so much. In everywhere, you start smiling. And let's start with the ethical, then we can deal with the political. Is it not? That's first beginning. I am not asking for annihilation of caste immediately. But minimum, moral minimum. This is a moral minimum, you will start smiling. And taking lead is producing first smile is such a big challenge. Because your ego, oversized ego really comes in the way of producing a smile. Make you smile, guru, who will smile karna chahiye. You as a humble person smile once, twice, thrice and you will get lost. That's it. So I think that's minimum. Then other structures, which are those structures, we just analyze them, which are really perpetuating. Then we have state, patriarchy, economy, everything. And patriarchy we haven't discussed. Role of patriarchy in perpetuating caste, I just mentioned that. And I want radical feminists to really react and attack me. React to this and attack me. But you know, let's see. I'm not in Olympic now, but I would like to go attend.
Yeah, my question was exactly what you just said. It was, you keep mentioning how you see women as the sort of tools of perpetuating caste. And I wonder if it's really women, because most of the time, especially in India, women are products of patriarchy.
Yes.
Can you see them as separate from the system?
No.
And when you see them as, you know, repositories of culture, they're the keepers of morality and purity and chastity. Automatically, they also become the transmitters of,
yes,
you know, traditions like caste. So I think it's patriarchy that probably perpetuates it more than women do.
Yeah, that's correct. You are actually substantiating my point that it's not women who are responsible. But you know, since the relationship between the first person singular and the ideology, that is important. Now, there was a debate in 1927, and I am just giving you this example. That some of the non-Brahmins said to Ambedkar, look, if the Brahmins are the part of the struggle, we will not be there. Now, what is important? The body, participative body, or the ideology behind it? Ambedkar says nothing, when you please stay away from the struggle, I will allow Brahmins to participate. Because it's not the body and the identity, the image identity which is important, the ideology behind it. Now, what one is expecting of women is to really see the difference. They take their first person singular so important that they don't want to really shed off or ward off the patriarchal controls that are really assigning rough edges to their personality. You just shed them off. Can you take that challenge? Look here, I am not going to follow this Chaturvarna. I will employ people, I will employ tribals. By the way, tribals are the most darling options for the Delhi fellows. But they are considered to be outside the purity position business. So they have a higher one priority position in the households in Delhi. So you have to this thing.
But isn't that
in the practice you have to do, as the Brahmins and the Kaista proved themselves to be on the side of, that is in practice. That's why Ambedkar decided to pay the cost of not getting non-Brahmin support. So we don't want it. So the matter of personality and principle is so important.
I was just going to say, that's more a question of female empowerment as a feminist problem than as much as...
They have to empower and they have to really interrogate the structures that really dominate them as a person. That's the real empowerment. Interrogate and resist it and then transcend ultimately.
Okay. This is part of something I was working on, positive notions of humiliation. I read my teachers like Sanjay Palshikar and Patnaik, and then to come from that, I was working on this in Andhra Pradesh. I was just asking some of the people, like, what do you feel as an alternative to caste? because you are humiliated basically. That's the point of departure. So they said conversion is an option. So they were, we brought in the question of religion. Now these people said, okay, I'm Dalit, so I would go into something more humane. I view as something like Christianity. Then I observed the pattern, I interviewed a lot of people. Then I got to know, even when they are converting to a religion like Christianity, it gets Indianized. When I say Indianized, he converts to Christianity, he remains to be a Dalit Christian, he remains to be a Reddy Christian, he remains to be a Brahmin Christian. They have separate churches and each of them are not allowed to go into the other ones. This is part one. The second part of my question is that even within the Brahmin, the women, they are also treated in that way when they go through their menses basically. That time they are also treated like untouchables. So what's your take on this?
The first question you will answer, because you have a very, very great example of the Tamil Nadu maid servant getting converted into Christianity, but positively for all the practical purposes, remaining Hindu and caste. That is no. This is the old question. I mean, the people do not really change. This takes a lot of time. That's why I said one of the important features of Ambedkar's conversion is he was able to really convert 3 lakh, 4 lakh people into Buddhism on that 14th of October 1956. This is basically after, I'm just exaggerating it, but after Jesus Christ and Prophet Muhammad. You know, that is a huge achievement. But this is not overnight, it's not magic, it is the deliberate. That's why it's not somebody, all the scholars in Buddhism say, oh, he just mesmerized them, converted them. No, that's not true. Deliberation was the important thing. They did not agree with it. That's so. He said, why he didn't convert into Islam, Christianity? For the same reason, there's no future. Buddhism is one place where you don't have casteism. But there also it has gone into. So there is the consciousness, there's always a lab. You always are held back. And it's very difficult to really detoxify yourself 100%. I'm not saying that even those converted into Buddhism are 100% completely detoxified of Hinduism. And I don't know what is this positive humiliation. Unless you say there's an instrumental value attached to humiliation, then I can take that point. That's the Ramesh Kamble thing. It's a stakeholder in humiliation. But that is not transformative. You know, and as in that book, Ashish Nandi would say, women participate in their own humiliation by not responding to the husband who are beating them. They are instead of really crying, they are really sort of, you know, laughing at and ridiculing at the husband. What is the moral criteria of really defining the humiliation? Articulating it to really respond, scream, cry, my God, like that. So your humiliation is complete. The tormentor will feel very happy that, oh, I could really extract that skin from my wife. If she is laughing at you, humiliation is not complete. So what is positive about it is the problem. And the second question is about what?
The women in the Brahmin.
Oh, that's it. I'm not supposed to give the answer, but I will give one. But the women should believe in women. I'm also feminist in a way, some kind of feminist. I was raising this point. All women are Dalit, dramatized again. In terms of their temporal untouchability, as I mentioned. Several women took objection to this Goa conference 1997. Wow, how we take objection? We are not untouchables. We are not Dalit. We are women. And then the very interesting justification they brought it was that 4 days, the cunning of reason, liberalism was placed into service of cunning. Who we are getting 5 days off from a heavy work. What is your soul deception? All these women who have read liberalism at some length are producing this. We are enjoying our freedom during those 4 or 5 days.
No, but the thing is, they are not supposed to cook, but they are made to sweep the.
They can wash the clothes.
No, they are in some cases they are relegated to remote corner, a dark corner. They are not supposed to do anything. They are not supposed to really spoil, mess up with the sacred sphere. Now that this must be, now that it is difficult. Now that's difficult for you.
Very much
there. So But is that the untouchability? And you have to expand, you have to offer expansive meaning of untouchability. Is this ritual? It is ritual, it's not simply physical. It's not simply physical, it's ritual. That's why it is very closely related to caste untouchability. So,
in fact, if you look at that, part of our debate is on this phenomenology in archaeology and history. It's actually on this point. That this is, Ambedkar writes about this in his untouchables. He says this is there, but these are temporal, as he said, and they are not to be seen as the untouchables because of this hereditary permanent nature. So, you know, we actually discussed this issue.
This time space dimension of untouchable is very important. So, in 4 days you are set free into this sphere, you are. But then you are absolutely sanitized, so to say. Your body is sanitized, you are not supposed to be carrying a stigma with you, that dirt with you. So that's it.
We'll take two more questions. Just a quick comment on Asim and their just on the conversion, there's another story, not that story which I told you. This is a friend of ours who are Christians, but who belong to a particular caste in Kerala. When they look for his marriage, this was an arranged marriage, advertisement, families, and so on. They were looking for a person in the same caste. Now, what is more important? He is a Christian. What if you got a Hindu in the same caste or a Christian in the same caste? What would you choose? So it is very interesting that eventually they chose a Hindu girl for him belonging to the same caste rather than choose a Christian from another caste. So caste actually triumphs over. The importance of caste relation triumphs over the religious affiliation. And there are so many stories like this, how people prefer to choose people from the same caste, even though it could be of, you know, particularly Hindus and Christians.
Mm-hmm.
And that says something about, you know, how people do this. Asim and then last one.
We have been talking about this long history of social stratification, but there has been a long history of evolution revolt against this kind of stratification. You spoke about 1920th century, about how Ambedkar converted so many to Buddhism, but there was Buddha himself 2500 years ago who raised these challenges, and there have been so many reformers who have raised it. So I wanted to ask this question, that where have we failed in addressing this question? There have been so many reformers, revolts against this kind of stratification. As in there are umpteen numbers of them. So as in where have they failed? Is it the theoretical conceptualization that they couldn't address of how caste has deeply sunk into it, or were they not political enough, or what was it, or were we not able to sustain that criticism over these thousands of years?
And as I mentioned to you, that you know, Buddhism emerged in the area where rice was produced. So that's one again and again. The other interesting thing is that where we fell, there is a series of rhetoric of tradition fighting against. First Brahmanic Hinduism, then folklore is Hinduism and Hindutva. So that's the trajectory. And Hindutva in other religion as well. In terms of caste discrimination. Now I am now thinking that, you know, the assimilative nature of Hinduism. You know, you are not allowed to really maintain your heterodox character, you are assimilated. The moment you think that you are facing a challenge, a very difficult challenge, you have failed. In the argumentative India, you have failed to really reason out with the heterodox tradition because you are much more superior. In terms of the argumentative power, Jainism, Hinduism, Brahmanism, Buddhism, against. So you couldn't really triumph over them, you started accommodating them. Now the question is, Buddha and Mahavira wouldn't have really accommodated into Hinduism. They resisted. But those people who were the followers of Buddhism and Jainism were always hoping to be accommodated in Hinduism at some point of time. Their aspiration, their ultimate desire is to be assimilated into Hinduism, was to be fulfilled. Was the desire which was always there with them. They were waiting for opportunities to come. So the first opportunity came in the very 6th century where they drove, I mean, they approached Pushyamitra Sangha and others, cut, harassed. You know this, what is this? Elimination of Buddhists and drowning the the text and not arguing with them and all that, cutting the Buddha tree, all that happened. But ultimately you assimilated them into the 6th, 7th century assimilation becomes a possibility. Then you also convert Buddha into the 9th incarnation of Vishnu. All that assimilation, promise, expansive. The moment you say Gandhi becomes a very, very effective person because he is using the assimilated character. Now he says, what is there? Everything in Hinduism. You have to be happy with Hinduism because there is a promise of everything. So your reaction is neutralized by really becoming, making Hinduism very, very accommodative, expansive. That's one. And not, that is the one objective opportunity offered, subject to aspiration to become the part of Hinduism at any point of time in the history. Is also responsible. That's one complex answer one can give. And the failure, of course, is that the people, if you are a stoic, I just don't need your certificate, get lost. That promise is not done. And there is a movement, a Rastafari movement in the US, in the UK. I don't want your certificate, sorry, I don't want to assimilate into any kind of reason. That is a big challenge. You really require some, and you have to be every third, and you have to require some moral, emotional, religious support at every point you lead your life. That's it. No, I would just add one small thing. Ambedkar chose this ism, which Buddhism, which at that point of time never had any state support. Nothing, very plain, pure option. And he chose that. There's a moral strength involved in this conversion. And yet many people did not, even among the Dalits, some people did not convert. Because there's no promise of assimilating at some level in Hinduism. There's a problem.
Sir, I'm going beyond what you said. Just one line, sir. So if we eliminate that box in all application forms, right from LKG onwards, and if we keep economic status, the true economic status, not the stated economic status, as the, you know, the thing to give privileges for those who are underprivileged, is it possible to remove caste or casteism or whatever? Ideology, but it's possible.
No,
because I tried, when I applied for my son's LKD, I wrote Indian, religion, nationality, Indian, and I the form was brought back by my son to my religion. So,
yes, you have a seat, please.
Yeah.
I mean, that's one way of looking at it. You remove the problem of caste, will caste him to disappear? We are assuming two things actually. One thing is that, you know, as if caste, existence of caste is related to this single sphere. Is that the case? Caste is having its influence much beyond reservation quota on that. You know, that's one thing. So that would not be sufficient. That's minimum thing. And other thing, government will not allow you to really remain. Why government? Not because Dalit wants government to really have. They may. But government is doubly interested in maintaining your caste. I have a long essay on this, but quickly. There is a village even today in Yavatmal district of Maharashtra. Everybody was Ajat. About 10,000, 15,000 people did not mention any caste. There was a big movement there and they existed outside the formal caste structure. So what happened? One generation went off, second generation went off, now the third generation today. They have written their caste as Ajat, their identity as Ajat. Government said, what is Ajat? We don't recognize it. You go back and write your caste. Because we want to distribute our benefits and implement a policy. So they become caste, Ajat has become a new caste now.
So that happened with Baswana also.
So I think the sphere of influence is much, much larger than this thing. You know, there are people who don't want to mention the religion, the no caste, they don't want to mention the caste, yet you are trapped into the whole thing. So the logic of structure is so telling on you, so it's difficult to really break open that and then start a new thinking. I mean, I would do with Arvind to really do some kind of adventurous thing here. But this is impossible. You then are wrong to really do anything.
And as you said, the family,
as
the central thing which sustains caste. How does one, more than the government, it's a family who puts a matrimony in that. It's a family who does all this stuff. How does one engage with that? That's, I think, the larger question. We take a last question then.
We've been talking about human society so far, and I would like to stay outside the idea of humans altogether. And the reason why I believe that caste is more than just a social structure amongst humans, something that you came up with, but is instead perhaps instinctive and natural to us altogether. All animals, and I mean from large society based insects, ants, and termites, almost all mammals and almost all birds follow a very rigid, strict system or social hierarchy structure based on hereditary genes rather than on how much you work. A worker ant, no matter how much food gathers, will always remain a worker ant. Right? And I'll give you reason what I've learned today. Three examples, three species I quite closely follow in this regard. Number one being hyenas, right? That is the most orthodox way of caste system in wildlife. They have small flocks, small herds, around 15-20 individuals, right? Out of which the leading strangely, the connection between all these species, the leading the one who enforces the caste system is always a female. The matriarchy rule followed, be it elephants, the grandmother elephant, be it lions, where the lionesses actually control the territory of hunting and actually provide for all the food, or be it hyenas, where the grandmother of hyenas actually enforces everything. They also have a very, very strict basis of sort of enforcing the caste system. The hyenas born outside of, for example, that grandmother or that mother, right, of that particular society, will always be at the end of the herd, right? They will always get to eat the food at last, regardless of whether they hunted down or not, right? Even if they found the food, they will first have to inform the family members itself, and they can come and inspect it if it was killed by her, and then they can perhaps even decide whether they should have it or not, because her blood has already stained the food that she has killed. Secondly, the example being that of elephants. We all know the elephants like have a structure of protecting the young by keeping them inside, mothers on the outside, and all the mothers who are not breeding currently, or are not mothers, or the females, on the outside. Even within that, the mothers, the calves from the line of the grandmother actually gets the innermost position straight away, right? So the caste, the genetic power, the one that has the best genes is immediately protected by the herd. If the grandmother dies...
The point you're making is that animals also have caste system.
Not just that. In fact, as you go towards chimpanzees, for example, the caste system becomes socially so relevant to humans, because what they do is, as you mentioned earlier, they base on territories, right? And they segregate within these flocks, at least they kept the caste together within one society. Chimpanzees all together segregate societies. And they control an entire forest if they have to. And they will not let, let's say in their words, what would be untouchable, even enter the forest. Right? While they have the right to go in there, again upon the impression of the
elders. So your point is what? I'm just trying to get you to, so you can respond to it.
We are perhaps more instinctively programmed towards creating a structure that is based on hereditary. Rather than creating something, rice is a good example because it enhances our territorial powers, which all animals exhibit, right? But I think it is not the rice that generated caste. I think it is the very need to be territorial and be powerful even within our own.
Okay, so that's a much larger thing, but you want to respond to the animal.
I mean, you are right about there are two. All animals are social. Best exist, that's what philosophers said. All animals are social, including four legged. But some animals are more social because of their intellectual capacity. Okay? This lazy one whose name is lion will always be on the hunting of lioness. Okay? You know patriarchy, you know this name. But that is not what we are talking about. We are talking about a distinct, separate, different organization, human organization, which is called caste. Where you have a human being using conceptual capacity to convert what is animal into transfiguring animal onto human being. See, that's the conceptual. You were trying to do something very, very fundamentally
very simplified process.
No, simply the sense. Why Ambedkar is calling? Why certain members of the society call certain members of the society as less than animals? They are not even animals, less than animals. For example, that can be, if they are calling Dalits as lions, fine, very good. That's why they are Dalit Panthers. So, fine. But five untouchables are killed for the sake of a sacred cow in Jajjar Kutas. Okay? And I am not going to go into dramatic fashion, but you are. Conceptual imagination, the image of a human being is less than a hyena. Ambedkar said so. Who are not allowed to walk in the street during the daytime. Similarly, hyenas. But that is hyenas and hyenas proper one-to-one relationship. The reality and the behavior are closely one-to-one immediately related, which is not the case in terms of human being. Your transfiguration takes place, that special quality of being super social. Okay? And that is Ambedkar who gives you some clue in this, you know. Therefore, you just, yeah. Well, there is a collective being, there is a community and all that is fine. In ants and you have a very interesting example, how they decide what direction they want to go, the swarm of insects and all that. But we are not swarms. We are family, we are individuals in that. We are internally fragmented. But politically, that's why idealism and the caste and ideology remains as a significant marker. Even though you are, and I didn't give you the Bombay example, Bombay examples are one of the fantastic examples of how casteism has given way to caste. But casteism is reproducing different forms at different places. So let us not, and the second implication of your argument as secularization of caste and all that, okay, you are already suggesting neutralization of caste as an essence. So what is that so special about caste organizations? It is there in animals, it is there in military, it is there in elsewhere. So forget about caste. Is that the suggestion one is making? So there is a, I mean, we have to go analytically and then perhaps politically. We have to find out what is human being reproducing caste among the animals into human organization. That's not the case.
Yeah, in fact, just to add this point, you see, the point is when you look at animals, that's a very important point you raise. So, when you look at animals and use human concepts to understand animal action, very often we run into problems. For example, this famous question of suicide of, you know, moths and lemmings and so on. Like, you know, insects which come in, so called commit suicide, when moths come to the fire. And some biologists have termed that, have used the word suicide. But is when the wasps go to this flame, are they committing suicide? Well, it seems like they are actually going there. But the point, what fundamental point of difference is a willful action. Wasps cannot seemingly know, have a conscious awareness that they are killing themselves if they go to. That's why you use the term instinctual, right? So there are two points about compare problem with the caste of animals and humans. One, not all humans in all societies show caste system. If it was so biological, out of the 7 billion people in all communities around the world. See, if you give the example of hyenas, you would presume all species of hyenas follow this rule.
But isn't that human consciousness triumphs over animal intelligence?
No, one second. So let me finish. Let me finish this. One second. I'll give you. So whether the hyenas have a universal capacity, as being hyenas, they might have some practices. What is so special to the Indian society? And that's the question we've been talking about. Why is the caste become so integral to one particular community or one particular society? Not a larger human universe. Because you don't seem to have this replication of a particular universe, right? That's the first point. Second point is intentionality. Animals, humans, any comparison between the two, if we cannot make sense of conscious intentionality, which is what we think makes humans special. You know, the real point is this. When we say, if I say, like all, and if your father, you know, if my father says, oh, you are like animals are very obedient to fathers, you also be obedient to me. None of us would listen. The point about being a human is to break everything that animals do. Because we think our will allows us to break that comparison. So why only for this we have to natural, so we are going to mimic the natural? So why, what he didn't say, and I think he was leading to, is that a statement like this can be simply very dangerously political. In order to maintain certain status quo, in order to maintain certain oppressive structures also. That's the reaction. I mean, I'm saying that is the intellectual question, why people would be worried about it. But doesn't remove the fact that you're asking a genuine question about comparison, just that it may not be possible.
The comparison is based on what we are now. Very simply, the origins of caste in itself. Again, with respect to India, also in believing in resources play a huge role. If you look at the countries which have succeeded over the years, in sheer resources per capita.
Okay, they are into very deep thing, which, you know, as social science people have been.
I think this is where, like, for example, animals do not progress into that kind of consciousness, that kind of intelligence that we have. That we have to break apart, like, these chains that we have of instinct, perhaps, or binds that we have from 6,000 years ago from territory alone or anything. Because we are genetically, perhaps, somewhere defined to be dominant.
Okay, no. Okay, I mean, this is a big question, but I'm just saying this because whenever genetic comes, it keeps pointing to me, and there's a reason. Because I think genetics is being completely misused by us to represent things which we don't understand or which seem suitable to us. Genetics has been one of the most problematic human categories we have created. Whether it was from Hitler and the horrific consequence of that, or it's about the race. Somebody asked about the question of race, the IQ intelligence tests on blacks in the US. You know, these were the use of genetic to me is a red flag. I mean, this is a different thing. I'm sure many of you biologists can discuss about it later on. But I think for many of us social scientists, the moment you say genetics, all the antenna will go. Okay? But we've come to, I think we need a much larger.
For a cup of coffee.
Yeah, okay, last point.
Good evening to all of you present here. My name is Swati Rao K. I belong to the religion known as Hindu, caste known as Brahmin, sub-caste known as Shivalli Brahmins. And I'm really proud about casteism in India because when I thought, I haven't read any book based on casteism. Seriously, I haven't read any book based on casteism. But
once,
yes, I tell you why. Because once when I was thinking, like, why do you think casteism arises? I know you guys are laughing once again. I thought, when, why is this casteism arise? I felt, basically humans have this tendency of dividing things. For example, you take mathematics, divide numbers. Whole numbers, integers, fractions, etc. You take social science, divide. You take that science, divide. You have this dividing mentality everywhere, every possible ways. So that's what happened in society also. You start dividing stuff based on the work what you do. For example, at the beginning, I think they thought, like, okay, whoever is doing patient work, okay, Brahmins. Whoever is doing the work of saving the country or saving the nation, do the work, okay, they got the Kshatriyas. Same way. I think this is all how it has arise. And later on, the people in between, they totally spoil the meaning of it. I think it's not important, right now I should not speak about why casteism, that lady suffers so much, this person suffers so much. Stop speaking about all this. It's not going to do anything for you all. I think you should start making casteism to be a plus point. Maybe because, like, if today you start, tomorrow if government gives me an application form, waiting, if I tell casteism, they should give me 5 blocks. Because, I'll tell you, I have scored 75%, consistency, I'm not a Brahmin. I don't know Kanati, I don't defend myself, someone is going to hit me, I'm not Kshatriya. I know to stitch clothes on my own, forget about this Levi's. And I know to stitch anything, I know to stitch my shoes. Okay, I belong to the third level. I flush my toilet whenever I use it, so I am Panchama. You should start doing like this, man. Stop speaking about casteism every time. Because it's not going to solve anything. It's not going to solve. What do you think that
One group of people say that we should cope up with capitalism, that is Dalit Raj. And then the Dalit Raj people say there is nothing called Dalit capitalism. So how do you address this issue?
I've been writing a piece on this, and with that Raj question, I can really prevent this now. First of all, Dalit and capitalism, these are two mutually exclusive words.
You can be either captain or vegetarian. You can't be both at the same. Okay? But now you are called as Dalit captain. So you have to understand the nature of Indian capitalism. And I am going to argue in that particular field that Dalit are called capitalism, capitalists are called Dalit because the genuine, authentic, mainstream capitalism wants you to remain with Dalit, the suffix. Because the capitalist nature in this country has become patronizing. And some Dalit fellow who is enterprising, shaking hands with Ratan Tata, oh my god, I've got the achievement in my life. Sometimes you feel so happy about it. So that is patronizing. What is somebody going to lose by shaking hands? These are not following attachment, because there is attachment within themselves. So the record in terms of attachment is very, very bright. I can say that and prove that. Very, very bright, very radical. And so much radical that the Parsis were really bad, and Parsis were welcoming Ambedkar in Mumbai, not so much in Baroda. That is there. But why one section is really trying to become capitalist? What kind of capitalist they want to become? I would say they are not becoming capitalist, they want to become millennial. And you can become millennial even outside capitalism. Through lottery, through luck and whatever. There are several channels which are available to you to become millennial but not capitalist. So I would say that they are not capitalist but they are millennial. They want to be millennial. So there may be one or two cases in Mumbai. I know there were some people who are recruiting about 4,000 workers in the company, the ship company in Mumbai. So there is also very, very peripheral capitalism, not the core. They are not producing in the core regions. So you are allowing them to exist at the periphery. So that extent you are patronizing them. So the capitalism in globalization is patronizing. It's a complex thing. The other people are against capitalists because in the root of capitalism, to become capitalist is a very painful route. Can you become a capitalist without exploiting your own people? Is it not? You might say they are not really following any kind of reservation. There is no need to follow reservation. You can get them easily to your car company. Who are these guys? They are only from the rest. Okay? So there is an inherent limitation in being capitalist. Okay? You have to undergo all that process. You have to respect your own people. And you know, how caste is associated with occupations. Who are scavengers? 99% Dalit. Who are rat pickers? Take any culture. Who are they? Take this would be example. Who are they? Take Mandarin. Who are they? Only Dalits. I have data about Delhi. And if you are interested in Kaveri Hills work on poverty and plastic capitalism, I have not. So there is a poor relationship between new forms of occupations and old forms of casteism. So how can you really? And one chap is going ahead. That is the neoliberal ideology. And that fellow is bandaged by everybody. Electronic media, print media, everybody is bandaged. Oh my god, there is a success. Karlo Dunya Mukim is the challenge, you can say. It is possible. Is it possible? You can go ahead with this patronage at the cost of really leaving some people behind. I'm not asking you to carry the point, carry the burden of the whole community. But the Milton Friedman option is not just available to you. You have to tag on to state. Because the civil society is too risky a proposal. I mean, as Arvind and myself are running this problem. How to really main civil society in terms of accepting the, not distributing, accepting the crime and the historical wrongs and rectify it. But they say, oh, Amari cow is so important than five Dalits. VHP, Vice President, went on record saying this. Gau Mata is more important than five human beings. And there is the person is gone. I have a very difficult point of human being, human rights and animal rights. You ask anybody on the JNU campus what is important, they will say human rights. Because our usually challenged friends are being bitten every day by the stray dog with whom we love, for animal friends. And biorealities should always find perfect combination between the two, harmony between human rights. Sorry, those dogs are not using their rational faculty to leave these people out and attack those people who are the culprits. Are they making any discrimination? That's the point. So I mean, and the problem, I'm sorry that person is not there, but I want to make this comment. I'm facing this problem. Okay. The moment you really deflate attention from the real thing into something, I know your caste. You don't need to tell me your caste. I'm sorry, I'm a very, very, very psychologically agile person. I read. I'm not a psychologist, but I can read what is happening in somebody's mind. I'm a what? Jamdagni, who can read somebody's mind?
Okay.
Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you for raising the level of